Lolele, Fakalofalahiatu, and welcome to TP Plus, Tangata Pasifika's summer series. I'm Alice the Kata. Over the next half hour, we'll be chatting to our panel about our topic of the day: are we taking the fun out of sport? We'll look at how sport is fast becoming a career pathway for many in our community and what that means in terms of the pressure on our youngsters. We'll also look at how our athletes are finding success in alternative sports and whether they can make a living out of their passion. Joining me to have their say, a women's long drive golf world champion and pro golfer, Phillis Meti.
Go Phillis!
Former All Black and now rugby coach, Pita Alatini.
Hello, thank you.
Hi Pita.
From the New Zealand Warriors women's side, we have Lorina Papali’i. And finally, our very own John Pulu.
Thank you so much. Former wrestler. Thank you. Arm wrestling.
Nice. Oh, that's what you're doing here. Great. Kia rana, everybody. Thank you for joining us. Before we start, throughout the show, we'll be playing a game of Who Am I? We'll give you clues so you and our panelists can try and guess who our mystery Pacific person is. Here's our first clue. I was raised in Rotorua and wanted to be an All Black. Well, that's pretty much every guy in this room, yeah. So it could be anyone.
It could be anyone, yeah.
Well, anyways, we'll see. We'll have more clues later, and we'll see if our panellists can guess who it is. But first, into our discussion, how do we think our Pacific athletes are doing at the moment?
Our Pacific Island representatives are doing a good thing on the sporting field at the moment. You know, past, present, and obviously future, with a lot of the infrastructure that's coming in organisations, which is great.
Flying on from what Phyllis said, I think it is through our schools, predominantly of kids into different schools, especially privileged schools. You'll find there's a lot of our Pacific kids that have been given opportunities to these schools, and there's a large community as such. I suppose before everyone was fortunate enough to be at King's College, you know, the numbers have truly grown in terms of our Pacific kids getting these opportunities, and it's flowing through to the sporting fields once they leave school.
Absolutely. There's success all year round. I mean, like the last 2 years, there's the Matea Matonga craze that happened, the Commonwealth Games as well, where all of our Pacific Island nations just totally dominated. For you, Lorina, how do you think we're doing?
The opportunities given, the Pacific Islanders are backing themselves and putting themselves out there. Before they were probably a lot more shyer or didn't realise there was a pathway in it, so now they're dreaming bigger and they're chasing it. They're putting their foot forward and then their families are backing them.
I concur. Yeah. 2018, when Tonga took on the mighty Australian team, that sold out game, and I'm so proud. We showed the nation how we can support a team, and we did it so well. MMT for life.
That's all my time.
Me too.
No, that was a massive highlight, I have to say. And it didn't only bring Tongans together, but the whole Pacific got behind them as well. Why do you think we are achieving this success right now?
I think there's an element of definitely the kids, like Lorena said, around the space of awareness. But the opportunities around that space is more and more open, and it's not just in, obviously you've got your dominant sports, but in other sports around, it's golfers, you know, we've got Pacific Island and that, and all around, and take it back to Peter taking his shirt off with the Tongan, you know, they got it.
You want me to take my shirt off? Oh, sorry.
But I mean, it's just been broadcasted so widely around the world now for kids to see, and therefore they see an open opportunity for them to follow.
But what about you, Phyllis? You play golf, which is not your typical Pacific Island sport, so how did you get into that and choose that over other sports?
Like a lot of other kids, you know, your parents have a give it a crack kind of mentality. So my dad tried it out and enjoyed it. And, you know, when you enjoy something, you research it, you watch it on TV. And when he realised that it could be a profession, he was like, look, you know, you could play, just start playing. I was playing netball and all these other different sports at that time, but just try it and see what happens. And he kept me in the sport. It wasn't until I won my first World Long Drive Championship at 19 where I decided to play professional golf.
Well done. Did you ever feel intimidated that you're the only person of Pasifika descent?
It's different. The mentality is different, the culture is different. Obviously, you know, being an individual sport, it's very lonely at times. But again, if you build a good team behind you, it's not just about, you know, like you by yourself hitting the golf ball. You've got people that help you in the background, mental coach, golf coach, physical coach, that bring you forward, and you know they try to pull the best out of you when it's time to do that.
I heard recently that the rugby girls they're picking a squad of 21 and they're going to be paid athletes. That is amazing, and that's growth. League will follow, but not as fast as the rugby, the path.
Their success, I suppose, the Black Ferns, the Sevens, their success has been prevalent to be rewarded. And I think every rugby player in the game is really, really happy for the girls because they deserve it, you know, and they've worked just as hard or even more. The fact that they did work and do both, and I think that's probably a really key point, I suppose. Growing up, when the game was only amateur, and I was lucky enough to catch it before it went professional, and where we could see genuine fun. And that's why I see in the girls' game at club footy at times where I see the girls just absolutely love what they're doing and playing, and know to a point that when it does turn professional, they'll get an opportunity to make a living out of. But
that's awesome, because the talent is there. It's undeniable, talent all over the Pacific Islands. Awesome, awesome discussion there, guys. But does everyone out there agree with you? JP, what do everyone think out there on the street?
Yes, everyone had a lot to say about this topic. Let's have a look.
Now, do you think we're taking our sport too seriously?
No, I think for us as a people, it gives us something to be proud of. No, really, I think it's something we're good at.
A lot of our Pacific kids love sport, but I reckon that a lot of our families should encourage our kids to continue on with sport.
Welcome back to TP Plus, Tangata Pasifika's summer series. Today our panel's talking about whether we're taking the fun out of sport. But first, here's the second clue for our Who Am I mystery person.
Yes.
I have a sister who really likes gold. Okay? Some people still look confused.
Yeah.
Some people still look confused. Yeah. Are we talking about jewellery here? Yeah.
Am I giving
it away? Save that. We'll reveal who our mystery person is at the end of the show. But right now, back to our discussion. So we've talked about the successes and the opportunities for our Pacific athletes, but how much pressure is there on our younger ones to exceed all the way to the top level? Pita, you're a coach. You must deal with this all the time.
Yeah, well, with the kids nowadays, majority because it is a genuine pathway, for a lot of them there is a lot of pressure, and especially in rugby, school rugby, especially in Auckland, it's televised. From there, it's depending who they get the information from of where their next, class would be. So some of these kids do feel the pressure for not only them, and then you get the parents on top of that, and your school, and everyone outside. So you got internal pressure sometimes with the kid himself, and then you get the external with everyone else's expectations, rather than the player only having his own expectation. And that's tough, and that's probably an area where New Zealand Rugby Union and all coaches and managers are really working hard with our kids with nowadays.
Lorina, you're an elite athlete, but you're also the mother of an elite athlete. So as a parent, this must be something that you deal with too, you know, not to put too much pressure on him. What do you think?
So he's gone straight out of school into professional league player. So I know not to put the pressure on him. We're there for him all the time, whether it's good, bad. But he's actually also a well-rounded kind of kid anyway. He did miss out on that teenage block where you get left alone to find yourself, but he's gone straight in. He's doing really well, moulding to the professional life. The media is there, the kids are there, so he's a role model and he has to be aware of all that kind of stuff.
Are we also teaching our athletes, obviously we want to win every time, but when they lose, are we teaching them to accept?
Important.
I mean, I've always wanted to be like Jonah Long, but there were millions of other people that were way more good looking than me. And so I want to be the next Mariah Carey.
But obviously.
In terms of teaching them to accept losing, because that's what I always look out for, when our young ones lose, they're like, oh, I feel bad, and they want to give up, and then are we teaching them, like, self-esteem?
That's a fantastic point. I think that's one thing that I do encourage our coaches to do is, yes, we all coach and we want the result, But we've got to coach the kids when they're disappointed and understand it's part of the whole competition.
What about off the field, the crowd? Because sometimes, you know, they get so attached to the game
the
that
sideline,
they
yeah.
start fights and it steals the attention from the actual sport itself.
Well, they talk about controllables and uncontrollables. Yeah. The crowds and stuff you can't control as such, and that's left to them. How you can control that is talking to your kid around handling that.
Dealing with it
in that way. So it's tough because I've got a 13-year-old boy turning 14, playing rugby, under expectations of myself at the same school and what have you, and it's been a big learning curve for myself in terms of, you know, put the father hat on and say, look, son, firstly, your enjoyment, and then secondly is you know, what you get out of the game, support you whatever way you want to go type scenario. You know?
But I have to say, pressure is also sometimes necessary. If you want to get the best out of your 100%. Kid, if you want to be a top athlete, there's a standard that you've got to perform at. So for you, Phillis?
The want to perform at the best of your ability. Like when you're young, your parents kind of encourage you into doing, like, do better, train harder, keep going, don't stop. Those things are all life skills that we learn. You know, they're talking to kids and learning how to be a good loser is also learning compassion and learning understanding and appreciation for, okay, you have good times, but there are also bad times that you have to appreciate so that you can learn to move forward. And like the pressures today on me now are things like, how am I gonna make a living? If I don't perform well, how am I still going to be able to make a living?
Yeah.
And, you know, if for whatever reason, you know, I get injured or hurt or something, do I have a backup plan after that?
Mm.
And this is where the education comes in. But learning how to handle or cope with pressure is another thing. And that's something that comes from not just within yourself, but your team around you, like your parents, your coaches, your teammates and all those kinds of things.
Backup plans are absolutely essential for our young kids.
You know, you kind of felt like you had a backup plan. I try to go through different other avenues and doing little papers and such. But I think so, in my stage, the passion was so strong that I thought rugby would just go forever.
Yeah.
And then when it did, and once I actually finished playing, I was lucky enough to have this role as still in rugby, but it wasn't quite exactly, I didn't know whether I really still wanted it in that space. It took me a while to really transition across. And that's where I find the struggle is with a lot of my era, maybe just before, or just a little bit after, of guys not having that genuine backup plan for life after footy.
Do you think there's enough support for our young Pacific athletes around mental illness?
I think that where I say my son is, they have a lot of classes on how to deal with the pressures, and I really enjoy that there is that to educate the mental side of it. But then there's also, most kids are spiritual, so we've got God at the forefront, like what's our purpose, where we're going, what are we meant to be doing, are we doing the best we can? You've got to love what you're doing.
Absolutely. You've got to be happy while you're on the field as well, hey?
But I like how the former players have gone back to start like things like the Pacific NRL camps. You know, they've become the mentors now, and it'll just continue like a domino effect. So when your son continues with his footy when he's finished, he's going to go back and help the next generation of footy players.
Well, I did things in a different manner where I got out of high school and went straight into sport and carried on with sport. And it wasn't until I went through a severe loss of like my grandma and then my dad, 14 months apart, it felt like our world kind of turned upside down. So then we had to cope with a different kind of pressure. You know, who's gonna fill the shoes of my dad? Who's gonna fill the shoes of my nana? And where does that leave my mum? So then you start to realize, well, there are some things that are a bit more important than sport. I went back to university and finished my degree in sport and recreation with a management major. And at that time also I was running golf at a golf club in Auckland. So, you know, different types of pressures. And it's not until you find a different pressure you realise there's more to life than just playing sport and having a career in sport.
You have to deal with exactly. But I think family is really the foundation of how to cope with most of these issues, right? JP, what did everyone think out there on the street?
Yes, we live and breathe sport, so here's what people had to say.
Promises that are put forward to our families and stuff, it should be the full package, not just sport, but education and the follow-up after sport.
A lot of our young people today are looking for things to get involved in, and if it's sport, if it's something that is able to, I suppose, exert a lot of their energy and it's a positive thing, why not?
everybody. Welcome back to TP Plus, Tangata Pasifika's summer series. Today we're talking about sport in our panel discussion, but first, here's the last clue to identify our Who Am I mystery person.
Ooh.
I don't like it when it rains, but I love the thunder. Bow, 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 bow. Underline thunder, underline thunder. Mm. Do you have it now?
Yes.
Oh. That's okay. We'll reveal that very soon. Anyways, back to our panel. We're asking, are we taking the fun out of our sport? So we've talked about our successes, we've talked about the pressures, but now we're talking about sport being a viable career pathway. For you, Lorina, can you make a living out of the sport that you do right now?
No. I have to work full-time and I coach CrossFit twice a week and then I train on top of that and then I get to train with the footy.
Wow, you have a busy schedule.
Man, you're doing really well.
And then I write a book in my spare time. Walks on the beach. Sorry.
Yeah.
But is that because there's not enough money in the sport?
Yeah, so for the women, we to pay our bills, we need to sustain a job. Some girls actually did give up their jobs and put their studies on hold.
Wow.
For the short dream. It was 8 weeks because we were on the field 2 to 3 hours a night, training in the morning if you're doing extras. So that's 4 nights a week, and then you're flying on a Friday and come back on a Sunday. So we were all putting our best foot forward, but we were definitely working hard to live that dream and play for the NRL.
In terms of rugby, for you, Pita, is there this sort of illusion that kids can have this amazing career and live off playing rugby?
Yes, there's definitely that pathway now. The money that they're offering, whether it's here but more so overseas, is ridiculous at the moment. That so much so that the kids can make a good living out of it. The key around the space is having the right people to make sure that look after that money, and that's the key, especially for our Pacific people, more so. Just making sure that it's going the right place, that it grows, that you know when they finish playing, there's still a good amount there for them to live off to a certain time till they'll you know pick up a job that will suffice them for the rest of their life. We came from era same as you know where we really did love the game and the passion around that, a lot of fun and you know the boys and the friendships we made. But and probably didn't pay too much attention to the other space again, just probably thinking it'll last forever. And that's probably a message we give to our kids that it's a short window, could be a 10-year period, but you can make it a very good healthy window for you for when you leave the games.
Phillis, can you live off of what you do? What's your situation?
Thankfully now I can live off what I do. I also have a team or a sponsorship group behind me that are willing to put some money forward. Which should, you know, it's not money to make me rich, it's money to keep me going. So airfares and accommodation and entry fees are all expenses that are quite big when it comes to playing professional golf.
And it's not cheap.
No, it's not. And I'm lucky, and you know, golf clubs and golf balls and all those kinds of things, they're all expenses that add up too. So I'm lucky that I have a sponsorship that is behind me that have faith in me to do my part. And in turn, you know, I do my best to perform as well as I can, but also make TV and do articles and stuff like that wearing their logos, which will give them exposure, which is the exposure that they pay for.
How do you choose which country to represent? I mean, that's the other thing as well. I mean,
oh,
we
that's
had
an
a
easy
whole
lot.
Yeah. I know what
I'm
your
Hawaiian,
example is.
So. Yeah.
Because that's a huge thing now with the MMT boys, how they all chose to represent Tonga, which opened it up for our
that
Pacific
made history,
Island. It really changed the sport, it really did. So for you, personally for you guys, what do you guys think?
I think it's hard. You know, with the structure, you know, we've spoken about structure earlier and how things are put in place for us to, you know, go along the pathway to professional sport. You know, our Polynesian countries are still catching up.
Yeah.
And I guess when the structure comes for that, so that we have places to step on or stones to step on moving forward, we will go back to representing our home.
Mm. Well, the trouble we have is our governance and within the sport back home in Tonga.
Yeah.
You know, I'm working with the Tongan Igaletai team preparing for World Cup 2020.
Nice.
And it's funny, since I've been in that environment, you know, I've forgotten how hard the struggles are for the boys, you know.
Mm.
But the beauty around the space is that we've got a great management group who understands that, who've come from backgrounds of a tier one country that's been well developed in terms of those structures. So we understand that we get to the boys just to really concentrate on the rugby, and we'll deal with the other side of the things outside without them having to concentrate on that as well. And
that's awesome.
Been a huge development in terms of what Tautai Kefu's really put through. And that's the challenge we're always going to have with our kids, is if once we get that alignment right within the islands, then our kids will have a genuine choice.
I've what offered to go back to Tonga, and they said no, so yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, this is for ping pong.
I wonder why. Yeah. Well, with all that said and done, do you think we are taking the fun out of sport, you know?
I actually got the opportunity to play for Samoa in rugby this year.
Nice.
And,
awesome.
Just because the timing was right for me, and as a woman, I could represent New Zealand in league and Samoa in rugby. So I feel the love, the desire, the passion, but different systems in place. And I really enjoy every time I lay down or play for Samoa. And the heart with the girls and the fun and the laughter is just worth amazing. But the girls and the team, they make you cry from the stories and the choices, because they have parents saying represent New Zealand. And but I was fortunate enough to enjoy both worlds.
Wow, what a beautiful story and a beautiful way to end things as well. But it's time to wrap things up. Time also now to reveal our Who Am I mystery guest. We're gonna give our panel 5 seconds to write their answers on the cards in front of them. You guys go for it. Who do you think it is?
Good
time. Tough
you
one.
You win a prize after this.
But JP, what did everyone out on the street there say?
Now this game was fun and we take this game very seriously. Let's have a look.
To be honest with you, I wouldn't know who that person is.
That the long-haired basketball player that plays in America?
Stephen Adams.
Stephen Adams? Is that right?
Very good. Our panellists, reveal who do you think is the mystery Pacific person.
Drum roll, please.
Let's start and turn it over. Let's have a look.
Oh, wow. Cheer. Some really good answers.
Okay. Stephen Adams, congratulations. It is Stephen Adams. You each get a limited edition Tagata Pasifika pencil. Well done. Well done.
Those are very special, though. Yeah. Not everybody has one of those, so
you
should be lucky. You should be lucky. Anyway, well, that's the end of this week's panel discussion. Thank you to all of our guests. Join us again next week for another TP Plus panel discussion. Our topic: Pacific identity and our connection to the islands. Thank you for joining us. Enjoy the rest of your week. Ka kite.